On this episode of MarketScale Mornings, we'll be joined by Ross Video CEO David Ross. David recently won another Best Ottawa Business Award to go alongside his 2016 CEO of the Year Award as recognized by the Ottawa Business Journal. Ross Video employs almost 800 people across the globe and just celebrated its 28th consecutive year of growth. So, what sets the company apart in the ever-changing broadcast industry? How have technological shifts in the market affected consumer expectations? We'll dive into how Ross Video's customer-focused culture has set the company up for success and what lies ahead in 2020.
All right, we're joined by the CEO of Ross Video, David Ross. David, great to have you on. How are you doing?
I'm great. Glad to be there.
Yeah. So just to re-inform the audience here a little bit, your company has been celebrating over a quarter century of consistent growth. Like we said, in 2016, you were awarded CEO of the Year in the Ottawa Business Journal. And you also have an Emmy Award for your open gear technology. Lot of accolades there. It must feel good.
It doesn't feel bad, I'll say that.
true that. So David, just quick thoughts. I don't know if you were listening to that story I tossed out, but there's a $9 billion fund for rural 5G connectivity rolling out. Is this something that is turning heads in the live production side of the media industry? You know, are people thinking, wow, this is going to be a great opportunity for us to take advantage of fresh 5G in areas that were typically underserved?
I think it certainly plays out and in the live production side of things, you know, there's one thing about sending the video up and the other one is sending the video back down again.
Right.
So when you're sending it up right now, a few years ago, the only way to do that was satellite. It was big, it was expensive. And then, you know, you started using more internet connectivity and then people started using sort of special backpacks and things like that. It would have like four or five LTE connections on them. As things have gotten faster, it's getting more and more easy. I think with 5G, you're going to be able to do more remote shots and things like that where you don't have somebody saying something, waiting 2 seconds, somebody saying something back. Because one of the big things about 5G is that it's not just high speed, but it's low latency. So a quick turnaround. So I think it's going to make it easier to do live production from a lot of different places with a lot less latency, with higher resolution. So I think that's great for more live video in general. I think it's also going to make a difference in how people consume the video. It used to be just watch TV and then you watch cable and then you watch cable and satellite and then you watch some things you know over the internet, and now it's just going to be better, faster, lower latency video in every type of format that you can imagine on every type of device.
Sure. So
that's a short answer.
Yeah, right. No, I mean, we could probably do a whole episode of this just on 5G connectivity and how 5G is going to change everything. It's going to change industry. It's going to change video production. It's going to change media consumption. I mean, it's pretty incredible stuff. But unfortunately, we don't have time to just talk on 5G. We've got a lot to hit your way. You know, something else that I love about how you approach your career is that you give a lot of TED Talk style keynote speeches. You often give the cornerstone keynote speech at NAB. Do you have any tips for getting on stage, for being that, high energy personality and captivating the audience? I always want to pick people's brains on their presentation ability and their methodology.
Wow. It's changed. I think in the earlier days, it was a little bit more wild. And I used to think that I didn't know what I was going to say any sooner than anybody else when I got up on stage. Now we do it a lot more tightly. So it's a little bit less fun that way. But at the same time, it really helps to know your topic and be passionate about it. I think, you know, I was just talking to somebody the other day about, you know, I think it's wrong that people have to do speeches in school where they talk about, you know, some Shakespearean play, or they talk about, you know, the life cycle of bees or something like that, that they just looked up on some online or something like it. I mean, that's not what speeches are about. Speeches are about things that you are passionate about, that you know really well, and that just come from the heart. It's too bad that a lot of people who are learning how to speak in front of people are not being taught to do it that way.
David, you guys have experienced a really remarkable amount of consistent growth over the last 28 years, especially in an industry and in a business that is always changing, always evolving. So what are some of the guiding principles or codes of ethics or ways that you guys have oriented your business to ensure that you have been growing consistently in an industry, honestly, that changes so fast and so quickly?
Wow, that's a big question. I think I'm giving another speech on that, actually.
Just do it.
This is a good opportunity to practice.
Yeah, right.
I mean, there's a short answer and there's a long answer and a million other ones. The shortest answer that I have is hire smart people and don't piss them off.
I like that answer.
It's actually so true. I mean, if things are changing, that's okay, because if you have people around you who know what's going on, you can bring new people in who are in the middle of what that changes are. You can attract companies that want to be part of your company that can augment what you're doing to make sure you're on top of things. But the trick really is to be working with them, to listen to them, to give them guidance and freedom at the same time as to the sort of things that you need. And what the market is needing, and is if you just do that with the right people, you just flow along with the market and start to lead it at the same time. It's not that hard from that point of view. There's another side of it though. I used to read a lot of business books, you know, over the last quarter century or more. I think I'm the only person who ever wrote read a business book on audio while running a half marathon race. but you know, it's one of the things is it's like the information is all out there on how to run a really good company. It's just a lot of people don't follow it. It's more of a question of not doing the hundreds of things that can take you down, as opposed to the quick fix, one easy way that's going to make you successful. Yeah, I don't know if Ross Video actually has had too many oh my God breakout products that revolutionized the industry. It's been a good steady focus on quality, people, customer service, technology, reinvestment, internally funded growth. You know, not getting greedy and just marching that forward. And companies that are around us that maybe are driven by other metrics than we are and different ideas eventually seem to trip up. And it is like the hare and the tortoise kind of race.
Is there anything unique about trying to maintain not only longevity, but consistent growth in the live production or media industry, if we want to get more general? Are there any tips that apply specifically there that you have to keep in mind?
Well, for us, one of the things was to expand the range of products that Ross Video offers. If we started with one product, it was called a video production switcher. Most people have seen them on TV and control rooms and things like that, you know, where it's ready camera one, take one, fade up to two. You know, those big lots of buttons and levers and things like that on them. If that's all we made today, like we did back, you know, like my father started the company in 1974, we'd be dead, or we'd be a 10-person company. Customers have expected products like that to just continually evolve and have tons more technology in them before. And a lot of that has come from our growth, our acquisitions, and our ability to increase our investment. And also when you can't always have a number one product. Sometimes you're number two, sometimes you're number three, you know, and you're in a reinvention, reinvestment time. If you have multiple products at the same time, well, not all of them are going to be at the bottom unless you're doing something really, really wrong. So you can have all your other product lines, whether you do them organically or you do them through acquisition, that are supporting the ones that are weak while you are able to retool and come back strong. And so broadening quite consistently our product line and adding all sorts of new technologies and it has been a huge, huge part of our success, I think.
I mean, the industry continues to evolve, like Tyler said, almost daily, it feels like. And some of the biggest shifts have been shifts in content delivery, I think shifts in attitudes for how people consume content, how often they want to consume content, and then just embracing mobile, embracing the idea that anyone can go live, you know, relatively frequently and with relatively high production value. That kind of democratization of going live, how has that affected Ross Video, both in some of the technologies that y'all put out, but also in your attitude for, you know, wanting to grow the business or wanting to reach new areas of the business, or at least staying adaptable to where the industry's going?
Quite a few years ago, we actually made a decision to focus on content creation. Mm. So you can sort of think about in the production side of things, you've got sort of acquisition and ingest of things that may be in TV stations. You've got the content creation, which is whether you're doing news, sports, entertainment, live events, outdoor, indoor, you name it, but you're creating the content. And then you've got the transmission on the outside. So Ross focuses on the content creation side. And so the fragmentation of the market has been actually quite wonderful for our business, because you still have all the television stations out there that used to be our only customers. And then it's expanded to the point where you've got the YouTubes of the world and all the corporate video and all the smaller guys and so forth. And there's just more eyeballs and more delivery mechanisms of more types of video. So it turns out that people need more of what we're making. Now you still have things at the high end, the mid end, and the low end, you know, with people with different budgets and different production expectations. So it's also made us expand the sort of offerings we have to make sure that we fit the needs of a variety of customers.
Before we dig into some of the technologies, some of the specific ones, there's kind of an industry trend that I wanted to pick your brain on. In journalism specifically, we saw a huge push in the last several years for getting rid of, or I guess shrinking the newsroom and embracing things like Facebook Live, Twitter Live, and saying, you know, native Facebook content is the way to go. This is where we're gonna reach a new audience. And it turns out that was kind of they were a little too bullish on that shift, and it's actually coming back to bite them. And, you know, the reach of Facebook Live was not only a little overstated, but doesn't have the longevity that was expected. What are your thoughts on how mobile live has affected, honestly, the industry that benefits the most from live production and has the longest history with live production, which would be journalism and news?
Wow. It's interesting because certainly, there's less eyeballs in TV than there used to be. I mean, that's pretty obvious.
Yeah.
So there's a huge shift that's going on in that content creation side of things, where they might have sent a huge truck out and a crew and things like that. And now you have the people who are shooting their own video, doing their own audio, and it's just them and a cell phone almost.
Whether I
would say that hasn't made the content creation any prettier, it's downscaling at the same time, but it's a necessary thing for the survival and to make sure that there's still things like local news all over the place, because their budgets are getting tighter. So some of this technology, which is funny, it's the same technology that's also pressuring TV, is also one of the things that's keeping TV relevant and around, you know, being able to go out there and do things like that. It also gives more news sources as well, being able to say, oh, there's somebody on site right now. We don't have to get a camera truck there,
right?
You know, who's got a cell phone, and let's do that. So it allows what used to be a slower moving broadcaster, you can say, to be on the air as fast as anybody else. It's like any technology, it's a plus and a minus always at the same time.
David, a while back when TiVo and DVR first started coming around, I think there was a question and maybe a conversation about, is there still a place for live production and live, you know, live broadcasts and things like that? But now here we are in 2019, about to be 2020, and live production, live broadcasts are as big as they've ever been potentially. So explain that trend maybe. How have you seen that evolution? And was there ever a concern that live broadcasts were gonna go out of vogue? And tell us where we are now and why live broadcasts have endured to the point where they're still immensely popular as we're about to hit 2020.
Well, one of the things I smile about is here we are right now doing a live broadcast.
Right.
and the fun of that, just like watching the Oscars, the Emmys, or anything else, is you don't know what I'm going to say next.
Oh, boy.
Live on air, right? And I think people feel that, right? Mm-hmm. People know whether something is live or whether it's been edited, canned, you know, and made perfect for some message. When there's live, there's uncertainty. I mean, it's almost like, you know, do you want to watch the football game live or do you want to watch it the next day and maybe even edit it a little bit down? No, you want to see what's going to happen when it's happening because there's an inherent excitement about that.
Yeah, no, I think you're absolutely right. So what are some of the markets then that we're seeing live production really expand into and grow into more as live? Again, there's that emphasis on that immediacy, on that excitement of wanting to know what's next. What are some of the fastest growing markets for you right now?
One of the big things is esports. Esports and the competitions, people watching other people play video games. I think maybe 20 years ago, if I'd have told somebody that esports was going to be, you know, an enormous, enormous market and where hundreds of millions of people are going to watch people move their fingers really, really fast, that was going to be a big, big business, I think people would have laughed just like you did right now because the description of it is just amazing.
Right.
But that's a live event that's a really interesting one. I mean, there's a lot of people that don't get a chance to play sports and get outside kind of the way they used to. And it's, I don't, for whatever reason, just the way the school systems work and things like that, and there's competition for people's times. So when you watch somebody, you know, who's like 6'7", you know, dunk a basketball, and it's hard to sit there and look and they go, okay, that's good. My dunk is a little bit different. I'm going to try that, you know. But when people who love video games can actually see what the pros are doing and literally a minute later, you know, fire up their video game machine and try the same thing. And so there's a connection that's happening with esports, with people, especially young people who aren't watching, say, live news and live TV as much as they might. They're now watching live esports and competitions, and it's actually relevant to them.
Look, I'm not going to lie, if you haven't watched the Tetris Championship videos on YouTube,
what?
I'm telling you, some of the best esports I've ever watched. The commentators know what they're talking about, the energy is high, and...
Tetris,
I'm telling you.
Man, I rocked Tetris on a Game Boy back in the
big.
Day.
I definitely recommend it, so I know where you're coming from. To hit on tech just a little bit, we've obviously seen a transition from standard definition to high definition. HD is now going to 4K, Ultra HD, big talk on 8K. I think that influences a lot of consumer decisions for the kinds of screens and the kinds of content that they want to view their content on. Same with, you know, B2B companies, same with kind of installs in lobbies and you know, the high quality video that we see in an esports arena or an actual arena. When it comes to live production and it comes to streaming live, is 4K, is 8K, is that a push towards ultra high definition as needed? You know, is that part of this next evolution of live production? And you know, if you aren't adapting to 4K, 8K, are you falling behind? Is it that same dynamic or is it a different one?
I think it's a different one. The majority of certainly of broadcasters, for example, are still, you know, on 1080i or 720p. They're a long way from 4K, which is, like 8 times the bandwidth of uncompressed video, let alone going to 8K, which is another 4 times more than that. There's a lot of arguments going on in our industry right now, whether or not people want high HDR more than they want 8K or even 4K. And the reason for that is a lot of people sitting at a TV, they can't see the difference. I mean, when you buy a 4K TV, most of the content you're watching isn't 4K. It's just some lower resolution that's scaled up. And for the most part, you can't see it. And another side, some of it, so it's compressed enough that a lot of the detail's gone anyway. Going to 8K 4 times more, you have got a really big TV and you have to really, really like being able to breathe in the screen because you're that close. So HDR is another thing that's going on, and they're even talking about HDR on just 1080p instead. Now, HDR, what that is it's more vivid colors and more ranges of black and white, which may sound strange, but you know, and if you have a flashlight shining at you, that you almost wince because it's like, wow, that's really bright, you know, coming through your screen. The problem with all that is standards. Every day I feel that there's a new standard and a new requirement for HDR, and they're not really all that compatible with each other. So we have a problem on the content creation side where we're not agreeing well enough on what we should really be doing for HDR. So we'll probably shoot ourselves in the foot on that one for a good long time. 8K, it's a lot of money, especially in the production side, for a very, very small benefit. And people really look at the dollars and cents on that. I think what's more interesting is continued production on smaller screens instead of the big ones. So I just saw an article recently that I think it was in Germany. Somebody just did a sporting event where they turned the camera vertically. So they did 16:9, but 9:16. They actually professionally shot, you know, a sporting event so you could watch it better on your cell phone, holding it vertically, which is really strange to me in a way because you can turn your cell phone sideways.
Right.
But it certainly shows that there's people that are thinking about the small screen as much as the big screen, and so there's a whole lot going on there too. I think the reality, to put it all together, is the world is fragmenting. Just like what we're seeing in the way you were consuming video, the sources of them, whether it's YouTube or whether it's esports or whether you're going to stadiums to watch it or whether you're watching news or whether it's cable and so on. That's not going away. It's just getting more and more fragmented. All the ways that you're consuming it and all the different technologies, they're going to fragment as well. We're not going in one direction. We're going in every direction at once.
Thank you so much to our guest, David Ross, for joining us today.
Absolutely.
And stick around. Tomorrow we will have Business Casual Radio, so make sure to tune in for that on MarketScale.com. We'll be talking about industry trends. We're going to figure out a little bit more about what we're going to talk about, maybe a little bit of a look back at the retail week that was, things like that.
Perhaps. So. And obviously, you got to stay tuned for my next episode of Ratified, which is the intersection of business and policy. It's a live radio show. It's going to be airing, I believe, next week, Tuesday. Stay tuned. We're still locking down some guests, but plenty of good content coming out of MarketScale. Everyone, thanks for watching MarketScale Mornings today. I'm your host, Daniel Litwin, the voice of B2B.
I'm your other host, Tyler Kern.
We'll see you next week.